Fixed. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, fixed. 7, 8. Good fix stored. Move to GPS 3. Dump receiver. DGPF load.
Hello, this is Mark Silver. At iGage, we've sold a variety of RTK GNSS receivers over the years. Every few months, a new manufacturer approaches us about selling their receivers. If we had no standards, we'd be marketing, selling, and supporting 100 different receiver models. It takes a lot of time and costs real money to write user manuals, stock loaner devices, and build a demo fleet, and learn the particular nuances of every receiver. For that reason, we only want to sell a few of the best performing receivers. Some of the ways that you might evaluate receivers are fairly simple to compare. Enclosure quality, resistance to dropping, availability of spare parts, connectivity features like cell modems, UHF modems, intrip casters, and servers, the stability of the supplier, especially the supplier's ability to provide continued support to us, iGage. Those things all matter. But the very most important thing for us is GNSS performance. We're interested in the receiver's ability to get good fixes under heavy canopy. Of course, GNSS performance is the hardest thing to evaluate. Basically, all the receivers work great in the wide open. The thing that differentiates them is how well they work under canopy. The stability of measurements over time under canopy. The ability of a receiver to get fixes under canopy. The probability of a receiver to get a bad fix under canopy. All the things that matter are under canopy. Many years ago, I realized that iGage had to have some systematic method for evaluating GNSS receiver performance. There's just too many variations in satellite constellation geometry. Canopy is too difficult to reproduce, and every firmware version for every receiver represents a new potential for source of fix quality problems. And since constellations are so variable, we can't really do an objective test. All we can do is compare two or more receivers for a very long time, over hundreds or thousands of dump cycles, to ensure that we expose engine problems under varying skies. We need a testing robot. I have a testing robot. This robot spins receivers, physically dumping them and forcing complete signal reacquisition. It simulates moving around under canopy. The robot is controlled by a geared-down stepper motor that provides half-millimeter repeatability. A Windows computer inside the building runs the control program that positions the receivers based on 2 Hz GGA and GST NEMA serial streams. The robot controller dumps one of the receivers, then positions it facing the sky, waits for a fixed solution, delays 5 seconds, detects and rejects noisy solutions, collects a 5-epoch, 5-second average. If the receiver doesn't fix in 45 seconds, the robot gives up and moves on to the next receiver. The time to fix, positions, satellite counts, estimated errors are all stored in a database. A separate plotting program allows us to watch the test proceed in real time and to replay the test and compare the receivers when the test is over. These tests are not something that you can ever do by hand. You need a testing robot. For today's test, the robot's situated on the north side of a 14-foot tall building under the eave line. I know from experience at this location that 15% of occupations won't fix within 45 seconds. The robot calls these no fixes. The visible receiver is an iGage iG9A receiver without tilt. Our lawyers won't let me divulge the other receiver model. Let's call it mystery receiver. No, let's just call it MR1068 for short. I'll tell you that MR1068 is a very popular receiver and is claimed to be the best receiver available under canopy. Of course, everyone claims that, so it won't help you unmask MR1068's identity. In a few hours, when this test completes, we'll take a look at the results.
Move to GPS 1. Dump receiver. Autonomous DGPS. Float.
Many hours later.
Well, that test is completed. Let's open up the robot plotter and see how we did. Okay, on the plotting tool, every single dump round is displayed on the horizontal axis here. Horizontal axis is not really time, it's the dump round. Some of the rounds take longer than others because the receivers don't fix as fast or never fix. So if you look through here, you can see places where the receivers are similar and places where their performance is vastly different. Up here at the top, you'll see that this test ran 1 day, 15 hours, and 4 minutes. That's a substantial time period. During that time period, we did 2,155 dumps on each of the receivers. So the mystery receiver, 2155, the iGage 9, 2155. Of those dump cycles, the mystery receiver failed to fix 175 times, 8% of the time. The iG9 failed to fix 4% of the time, 78 times. So less than half as many no-fix events. That means, I believe, that the iG9 gets fixes under constellations that are more difficult. You'll notice here that the mystery receiver, which we're not naming, got 11 bad fixes. So of these 2,000 rounds, 11 of them were demonstrably bad fixes. The iG9 got one. Now, this program evaluates bad fixes by looking at the average and then taking population points that are more than 5 sigma from the average. So it figures out which rounds resulted in a fixed solution that was more than 5 standard deviation from the average, and then marks those as bad, and then recalculates cleaned averages. This is so that bad fixes don't bias the averages substantially. So if you look down through here, this X value is the longitude, and you'll see this is the cleaned range. This is after the bad fixes are removed from the mystery receiver. And you'll notice that it has 7.1 centimeters of range, where the iG9 is 5.2. So the iG9 is better than the mystery receiver. If we go down to the clean range on the Y values, again, 15 centimeters for the mystery receiver, 12 centimeters for the iG9. So the Y value is equivalent to the latitude, more or less. So this delta XY is a 2D difference from the average. So this is the horizontal error from the average, or difference from the average. And again, the mystery receiver is 6 centimeters, iG9 is 5. Look at the ranges. The mystery receiver has a cleaned range 22.5 centimeters, where the iG9 is 16.4. Again, the iG9 has a tighter set of results than the mystery receiver. One thing that the mystery receiver does well is it fixes quickly. And you'll notice the average time to fix, and this is after the bad fixes are removed, 7 seconds and 11 seconds for the iG9. So about 4 seconds faster in general for the fix. However, I think we'll all agree that getting bad fixes quickly is not necessarily a great thing. Now, as you look at these results, one of the things I want you to take away is that if you came out and looked at the performance, the comparative performance of these receivers through some periods of this test, they're essentially the same. There's no difference. So if you came out here, you'd say, oh, well, these two receivers are about the same. But there's other times, and this is because the constellation is changing, where the performance of the receivers is significantly different. You can see here, the mystery receivers had a long string of failed fixes where the iG9 got fixes. They were a little bit wild, but it got them. remember, this is under extremely heavy urban canopy with engineered reflections from metal surfaces. But this is, in my opinion, where these receivers need to do well, and that's in difficult conditions. In the testing I've done, I've taken the robot out into the wide open, and all of the receivers do extremely well in the wide open, which is great. Again, you need a testing robot if you're going to do tests that are not undersampled. Now, I know that our competitors are going to have all kinds of issues with my testing methods, and I don't blame them. But if they're comparing performance based on running a quick test under canopy and they take a couple shots for a short period during the day, who are you going to trust? Because I run these tests comparing our receivers against most other receivers, I can tell you that we know the performance of our receivers is excellent compared to all other receivers. Not many other equipment dealers can make that claim and back it up with hundreds of thousands of dump tests. So what's the payoff for iGage? Well, because we're not selling junk, our support costs are significantly lower and our prices are as good or better than any other source. Because the equipment we sell is good equipment, we can sell it for less because it's easier to support and service. If you have any comments or suggestions, please feel free to drop me an email. My email's at the beginning of the video in the title. So here's to great GNSS performance, fantastic support, and reasonable pricing. Good day.